to our practical exploration of MinIO, a fully open source object store akin to the likes of AWS's S3 or Google Cloud's cloud storage. Today we're going to roll up our virtual sleeves, set up MinIO, and showcase its use. While we're using a Kubernetes environment as our stage, the principles we discuss are widely applicable, whether you're pivoting to another cloud or to an on-premise context. Not only will we be unpacking how to set up and use MinIO, but we'll also review its fundamental concepts like buckets. So, are you ready to get firsthand experience with MinIO? Let's stride ahead and create a Kubernetes cluster for our deployment journey. We're starting in a fresh Google Cloud project, so need to enable the Kubernetes Engine Service API as our first step. As that's setting up, it's the perfect time to delve into the deployment instructions for MinIO. When we look closely to find the deployment commands, we find the default pathway to be a MinIO Kubernetes plugin approach. This could be achieved with Crew or even streamlined from GitHub. However, this process is a bit opaque, hard to debug, and unusual. Instead, especially for those already comfortable with cloud-native concepts, Helm feels more controlling and comfortable. Thus, we're choosing this secondary path and installing the operator through a Helm-first approach. So, at this point, our API has been enabled for using the Kubernetes Engine Service, enabling us to create a new cluster. Opting for a standard cluster grants more control over fine-tuning storage systems like MinIO, so we'll avoid the autopilot option. To reduce your monthly estimated cost, you could minimize the node size or number. However, being billed per second means you won't incur high charges, providing you promptly delete your cluster once you're done following along. Let's click to create the cluster and then wait for a few minutes. Post-creation, we'll employ the Cloud Shell to execute our deployment commands, but only after ensuring we authenticate with the cluster. This is creating a MinIO operator namespace in our cluster, but that should be just fine. Great news! We've had a successful release and have been given some insightful instructions suggesting that we need a JSON web token for accessing the console. We'll grab the token now to stash it for safekeeping. Following the guidelines, we can also port forward to the console, but we'll get to that shortly. Now, I strongly recommend that you understand precisely what Kubernetes resources are involved with Helm-based installation work. We can do this for our MinIO operator in the MinIO operator namespace. Looks like we've installed a treasure trove of resources, including deployments, services, RBAC type assets, and custom resource definitions. Should this have been sourced from a suspect software provider, we'd want to check the roles to ensure we haven't given an operator excessive permission over our cluster. Thankfully, MinIO is a gold standard project, and we're probably in safe waters here. This all looks good and nothing crazy in the install. If you remember the instructions printout that we got after the Helm installation, there was a console access bit executed via port forward. So let's check out that service and indeed do a port forward. Now, instead of doing a 9090 to 9090 port, I'm going to use 8080 as the source for the port mapping, just so we can access the console more easily with our Cloud Shell editor. And I'm having a major mental glitch right now, forgetting what the abbreviation is for service, so we'll just spell it out and preview on port 8080 to get that MinIO instance. All right, so this is coming up nicely. It's asking for that JSON web token that we had saved earlier, so let's grab that and log in. Now, off the bat here, it's suggesting that we should create a tenant. A tenant in MinIO is an isolated instance of MinIO with its own storage namespaces, buckets, and access policies. This is critical when you need really strong isolation for security or multi-tenancy, for example. Let's go ahead and create that tenant. Now, for the sake of simplicity, let's stick with the default setup. Once we've got our hands on the console login credentials, we should note them down somewhere. Here we can spot our tenant. If we explore further, we can discover more details like the Docker Hub image that we've adopted. As you refresh the tenant here, you'll observe various stages of provisioning. It was not ready before, but now it's initialized. Again, keep an eye on the Kubernetes resources that you're actually creating when setting up this MinIO system. We just brought a tenant into existence. Shall we dive in and inspect the services we've just released into the wild? So, not only do we possess a public IP for our MinIO instance, bypassing the need for a port forward, but we also have this tenant console. Moving along to access, we'll need that username and password from earlier. Now, are you ready to dig deeper into some crucial MinIO concepts? First up, let's discuss the concept of a bucket. Buckets play a crucial role in organizing objects, kind of like a file system. They're not precisely a file system, but think of them like one. We're blessed with capabilities such as file locking, quota utilization, and even file versioning, all pretty helpful for real-world production applications. We'll go ahead and create a bucket right here, highlighting its read-write accessibility. For those of you familiar with cloud concepts, this might ring a bell. It's quite similar to S3 or Google Cloud Storage. Even the naming parallels are striking. If I venture into Google Cloud Storage and create a bucket, we'll see something that very closely mirrors the MinIO setup. These both act as standard object storage systems. Let's seize a quick screenshot and place that image into our bucket. There we go, we have an object inside our bucket. Similarly, in MinIO, we'll navigate to the object browser where we choose our example bucket and upload the file. These buckets serve an impressive array of use cases. They could be employed for storing media or even user-supplied content for a web application. You could also use them to store configurations or set up a backup system. Object storage, whether through turnkey cloud services or through something like MinIO, offers a simple, efficient way to store a diverse array of file types, be it structured or unstructured, plain text or binary. The final vital concept we must delve into is access. Regardless of whether we're accessing MinIO programmatically or manually through the console, the sacredness of our data safety can't be ignored. Let's journey to the identity section and select users. We'll bring to life a new user to demonstrate this. We'll bestow this user with the name Demo and won't assign any policies at the beginning. Once we log out and log in as our demo user, unsurprisingly, we don't see any buckets or objects. That's because our hands aren't graced with bucket or object permissions yet. Let's refer and log in using our administrative level account and revisit this policy system. While we're jumping around with manual accounts, yes, with MinIO's identity system, it's seamless to link with OpenID or LDAP type identities and even spawn MinIO groups, ensuring optimal user management. However, regardless of how your identity setup pans out, granting permissions via policies is non-negotiable. Let's breathe life into a new policy. As you might deduce, this is a JSON formatted file eerily similar to the policy specifications in AWS's S3. We'll draft a policy extending all permissions over all resources. There we go. After a couple of tweaks, we've got our enabling policy set up. Now, let's revisit our demo user and award this newly minted policy. By logging out and logging back in, guess what? We see that new example bucket as well as the object within it. Of course, there's more things to explore here around replication, lifecycle management, and bucket event-based functions, but hopefully we've highlighted how you can use MinIO at least in the console. As far as using MinIO programmatically, it features S3 API compatibility, so for lots of software systems that support programmatic access to S3 objects, you can use those same SDKs and methods and just point them at your MinIO instance here, and you'll get the desired behavior. This will very nicely integrate with existing systems that use object storage because of that S3 API compatibility. Also note that there's a CLI that can be used for some of the things that we went through today, as well as other work. So we can set up things like identities and policies using the MinIO client or the MinIO admin client. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll keep an eye on the comment section for any questions. Please enjoy responsibly.